I've got the top of the hour, so I think we'll get started here. I'd like to welcome everyone, and I hope you're all having a good day so far. The focus of this presentation is on ways to build recreational trails for walking, horse riding, and light vehicle use, as well as different methods for stabilizing embankments near trails. I'm your host, Corey Schneider, Business Development Manager with Presto Geosystems. We are located in Wisconsin and manufacture erosion control, stormwater management, and porous pavement products that are used all over the US and the world. I have everyone muted for this presentation, so if you have any questions during it, please type them into the question window and I will answer them at the end. Here are the things I hope you get out of today's presentation. I want you to understand how to properly build trails to reduce the impact to the surroundings, how different trail uses can affect the design, how to build through wetlands or other environmentally sensitive areas, and which products are most applicable for unique conditions that may be encountered. We're also going to touch on wall and slope design to ensure that embankments along trails remain stable. Presto worked with the Army Corps of Engineers to develop geocell technology in the late 70s and has been innovating ever since. Our products have been used in over 200 countries and in every state in the US. And we do go beyond simply providing a product. We have design and construction resources available for engineers and contractors. We do have our own experienced engineers on staff. We can help do project evaluations to recommend specific solutions based on the specifics of your application. We do also provide contractor support, so either someone from Presto or one of our experienced local distributors can be on site to assist once the project gets underway. We basically operate in three different product areas. Soil stabilization using our GeoWeb geocells, which can be used for load support, slope and channel protection, and building green retaining walls. Porous pavements, of which we have both vegetated and aggregate solutions. And then we also have a line of lightweight reusable construction mats. Today we'll cover some GeoWeb solutions, as well as our aggregate porous pavement product and one of our construction mat products as well, all of which are used for trail stabilization. An important thing to keep in mind as we go through this presentation, all the trails that are made with our products are considered permeable trails. That is, there's no impermeable paved surface being placed. The final surface is going to be stone or sand and will allow for water infiltration. This will lessen the environmental impact of the trail and reduce the amount of heavy equipment required for installation. And many of these installations are often in difficult to reach locations. So this will improve the overall cost and speed of the projects. We'll begin with what makes a good trail. The first thing to look at in design is the reinforcement of the trail area. Especially when the trail moves through sensitive areas, keeping the path intact is how you keep people away from damaging vegetation or from wandering off the trail and causing damage to the surrounding environment. The trail needs to be clearly delineated and needs to be reinforced enough to stay in place over time. Using products specially designed to act as the reinforcement of the soil or stone means that the trail will last longer and not encroach on the surrounding environment. The next key to a well-designed trail is drainage. Ponding water can ruin a trail surface, and water that runs off the trail into unreinforced areas can scour and damage those areas. As I mentioned, all the products that we use are going to be considered permeable, and it's precisely for this reason. By keeping the surface permeable, the water will infiltrate at the point of contact, right when it hits the trail. This water can then permeate down through the product and into the subgrade, entering the groundwater system. The water won't pond at the surface, and it won't run off or collect outside of the reinforced areas. This keeps the trail in the same condition no matter the weather, so there won't be any flaws or failures created below the surface that you can't see. The last thing to consider when designing a trail is how to confine the surface. Loose aggregate, be it stone or sand, is easily moved under shoes, hooves, tires, and water, leading to ruts, holes, and generally damaged trail areas. When the trail surface is damaged, people are going to want to move around the damage, leading them off the trail and into unprotected areas, potentially disturbing sensitive environments. Keeping the surface in place is an important feature of the products from Presto. When the stone or sand is properly held in place, ruts cannot form and the material can't be washed away. This will greatly reduce the amount of maintenance required because the trail surfaces aren't degrading. So the first product that we'll look at is the GeoWeb three-dimensional soil confinement system. The generic term for this would be a geocell, which is a term you may have heard before. They're kind of similar to a geogrid, but they are three-dimensional so that they do have depth to provide true confinement and can be used in a wider variety of applications than can grids. The GeoWeb system consists of two main attributes. You've got your cell size and your cell depth. The cells come in one of three different sizes, 8 by 10 inch, 11 by 12 inch, and 18 by 20 inch. And then, as well as coming in four different cell heights, 3, 4, 6, or 8 inch depth. The combination of cell size and cell depth depend on the project details and loading requirement. The seam strength is very important to the function of the cell. The stronger the seam is, the better designed the geocell is. A strong seam will allow for heavier infill material, as well as steeper and taller slopes, and provide better lifetime performance. The strength of the panel material, in our case, high-density polyethylene, is also critical to the strength and performance of the geocell system. The GeoWeb system, again, is a three-dimensional cellular confinement system, meaning that the panels have individual cells that are filled with an infill material that ultimately makes the final surface of the trail. By confining the infill material, the system distributes the loads and prevents rotting, and the cells keep the infill in place so that it doesn't wash away from stormwater runoff. The surface of the trail is going to be stable no matter what infill is chosen and may require very minimal maintenance for the lifetime of the project. Let's look at some different options for building stable trails with the GeoWeb system. Walk, run, cycle trails are meant for people, small animals such as dogs, and bicycles only. This type of trail is not meant for equestrian use. These are the most common types of trails and oftentimes go along shorelines, through urban areas, or through forests and parks. The flexibility of the GeoWeb panels allows for smooth, natural-looking curves. The panels can be held open with stakes, as you can see here, but those stakes are generally not permanent. They can be removed once the panels are completely filled. Each panel is going to be about 8.5 feet by 25 feet long and can be laid either along the length or the width of the trail. The panels are easily field cut with a saw or landscape shears and are securely attached together. No matter what dimensions your trail are, there is generally going to be very little waste as the panels can be pieced together in nearly any configuration. Here we can see the finished trail surface using a local granite aggregate and growing vegetation on both sides of the trail. The trail is clearly delineated and meets up with existing paved trails in the distance. The geoweb panels will keep the trail in place and level, minimizing surface erosion and potential runoff of contaminants into the adjacent waterways. This path used granite, but any type of stone is going to be acceptable as the infill material. So you can generally use whatever is local to your area without needing to import expensive engineered aggregate. As I said, it's easy to field cut the geoweb panels to accommodate the trail dimensions, even rather narrow trails like this one between a road and a protected wetland. By having the geoweb panels create the trail, water runoff from the road won't wash dirt into the wetlands because the water will be able to infiltrate through the permeable geoweb surface, keeping the dirt surface in place for, in this case, a nice jogging path. Paths through neighborhoods or urban areas can augment or replace traditional sidewalks in places where drainage is a concern. Replacing broken and ugly concrete sidewalks with gravel surface paths allow for flexibility in design and aesthetic, and will improve the safety of the walkways for pedestrians. These types of trails are good for any typical sidewalk traffic, but can also be designed to support vehicles as well. A 3 or 4 man crew can install about 1,000 square feet of geoweb per hour, including laying a geotextile fabric and infilling the panels. The geotextile helps to create a separation layer between the natural subgrade and the infill material, especially important in areas of very soft subgrades, such as a wet clay. The flexible nature of the geoweb panels allows for accommodation of hills and dips in the paths and allows the system to be pitched to one side if needed. Because geoweb gives additional strength to the infill material through confinement, cross sections can be cut in half or more, reducing excavation, aggregate, and maintenance costs. We do recommend overfilling the geoweb panels slightly when installing so that there is a wear surface over the panels and the plastic is not visible. This surface will become naturally compacted over time as the trail gets used. Having the panels slightly overfills helps protect the geoweb material from vehicle tires or other potential damage. Equestrian trails are next, and they have some different requirements than walking paths. Equestrian trails have to be hardy enough to stand up to horseshoes while remaining smooth enough to avoid damaging their hooves. Horseshoes can pick up a surprising amount of dirt and debris with each step, and with their heavy concentrated point loading can cause quick deterioration of the trail. If the trail is designed to withstand horse traffic, it is more than sufficient to handle hiking, biking, and small motorized vehicles. A geoweb trail system was utilized for erosion control for the equestrian trails that we see here. The gravel surface is resistant to rutting, and the 1-inch stone size is easy for the horses to walk over. This aggregate path will not get muddy or create sinkholes, so the surface will remain ready for use even after heavy rain or heavy use. Having a well-defined path also helps prevent damage to areas off the trail, and using the geoweb system allows for inclusion of natural markers, such as the large boulders we see here on both sides of the system. Now we're going to walk through a case study for a shoreline trail in the city of The Colony, Texas. This project was a multi-use trail along the lakeshore of a lake, along the shoreline of a lake. This trail will see pedestrians, bikes, small vehicles, and potentially equestrian traffic. The client, which was the city of The Colony, wanted to follow the natural contours of the shoreline, which the flexible geoweb panels can easily handle. There was a concern about the potential for uplift under the system due to the very high water table and lake level fluctuations. So here, additional steps were taken to prevent this uplift from occurring. A series of polyester tendons were run through the geoweb panels and were anchored multiple times per panel. The tendons, in conjunction with the final infill stone material, prevent the system from lifting and deforming due to groundwater pressures. This is a good practice in wet environments and with potentially saturated soils. A well-graded decomposed granite was chosen as the infill material as it was readily available in the area. Again, using local materials is encouraged, though any type of stone is acceptable as long as it is angular and allows good drainage. This means that you're going to want stone with limited fines so that water can percolate through the system. If the water can't infiltrate, you will get ponding at the surface, similar to a paved surface. So you want to make sure your infill material avoids this problem. And you should keep in mind that this material is going to be your final surface, so aesthetics may be a factor in choosing your infill. Once the geoweb panels were installed, the infill was placed in a standard front-end loader, then raked by hand to ensure all the cells were fully filled. The material should be placed on the outside of the panels as needed to match the final grade and meet up with unexcavated areas. For ease of construction, you can drive your vehicles and equipment on the panels as soon as they are filled, right up to the edge if necessary, so you don't have to wait for the entire system to be filled before using it. This can help to minimize the impact of construction in the area, since you won't need to create access lanes or clear out excess vegetation on the sides. A small smooth-barreled roller compactor finishes off the job. This is where having the wearing surface of overfilled material mentioned earlier comes into play. The compactor isn't driving directly on the geoweb panels, and you can easily visually confirm that no cell is underfilled. And again, the stone infill should have minimal fines. Generally, we recommend less than 10%. Avoiding your fines is going to allow the system to stay permeable. Trails built with the geoweb system are a great example of green infrastructure, as they don't disrupt the water cycle or impact the groundwater flow. You won't need any additional stormwater infrastructure when your trail surface is permeable, so there's minimal impact on the environment around the trail. Here we can see the nice clean trail created using geoweb, allowing for most uses without having to worry about needing constant maintenance. The path is clearly delineated while maintaining a natural look that people won't mind seeing in their backyards. So going back to the City of the Colony Trail, a few months after the installation, there was a large rainfall event over 7 inches in a 3-hour period, which can be incredibly damaging both during and after the storm. Several portions of the trail were flooded to the point of standing water at the surface on and around the geoweb protected areas. But thanks to the geoweb system and the extra precautions, such as the tendons used for anchorage, the trail was not washed away as you might expect from an unprotected gravel trail. The trail is still usable, allowing maintenance workers access to the damaged areas for inspection and repair. No repair was actually needed to the geoweb system, and once the water was able to infiltrate, the trail was good as new. When there is such a large rainfall event, the groundwater generally will become saturated and it won't allow for water to infiltrate. This water has no choice but to stay on the surface and become sheet flow. The geoweb system protects the trail surface against erosion when this happens, with the cell walls functioning as a series of check dams, keeping the infill confined within the individual cells. Then, when possible, the water can permeate into the ground and the trail is still in good shape. Now we're going to move away from the geoweb system and look at another option for confining your surface. This will be similar in that it does confine the material, but here we're going to use a rigid paver structure called geopave. Unlike the geoweb material, which is typically 3 or 4 inches deep for trails, geopave units are just 2 inches deep, and unlike geoweb, they are made of a recycled high-density polyethylene. The geopave units have these rigid paver characteristics with specific features needed for performance with aggregate infill. The main one I want to highlight is the monolithic mesh bottom. This is molded in place mesh on the underside of the paver unit. The mesh is going to keep the stone infill from migrating under the unit, and the integrated nature assists in the overall rigidity of the paver unit. The lattice bottom spreads the load similar to a snowshoe, so the wheel loads do not create ruts. Geopave units are locked together with a connection device to create a fully integrated contiguous pavement that is highly resistant to traffic stresses. As I mentioned, the geopave units are only 2 inches deep, which can be a real asset if the project requires a thin cross section due to buried utilities or high excavation costs. We'll now look at a few project examples using the geopave. This project is an access trail for walking down to a swimming area on a lake. The walkway had to be ADA compliant so that everyone could use it. It was also important that the trail help reduce runoff into the lake, so the permeable nature of the geopave system was critical. You can see the eroded trail before stabilization, both the trail surface and the surrounding areas, and the new trail area on the right stabilized with geopave. The protected system will help prevent erosion from stormwater runoff and be a smoother surface for walking on for the visitors. Here's another trail in a wetlands area. In this case, the geopave units were placed directly on the subgrade, but a geotextile separator fabric and a base layer of aggregate underneath the panels can be incorporated to support heavier loads and or to add additional detention capabilities. No matter the section, the entire system creates a flat, stable surface, and it will support whatever loads are anticipated. The same principles that we discussed with the geoweb system apply here as well. By using an open graded aggregate stone with minimal fine content, the water can infiltrate at the point of contact, reducing surface runoff, and the individual cells confine the aggregate, preventing rutting and washout of the stone for a stable walking surface. Major concern at this nature center was protecting sensitive tree roots from impact damage. The geopave units are a great way to provide tree root protection by creating a bridge over the roots, so there's no direct contact from vehicle or pedestrian loads that could harden the trees. This bridge lasts the lifetime of the geopave trail and allows the trees to grow unimpeded. One of the great things about building trails with the geoweb or geopave system is the amount of choice you have over the final look of the system. At this project in Door County, Wisconsin, two different rock colors were chosen to delineate the parking from the walkways. A light colored crushed limestone was used for the parking areas, and a contrasting reddish brown buckshot crushed aggregate for the walkways. Additional delineation, such as concrete parking stops or the snap delineators that we can provide, can also be included to help create a sense of separation within the overall geopave system. This project ultimately earned LEED Gold for all of the low impact structure and landscape elements. Protecting the local watershed was the primary reason for the inclusion of permeable parking and walkways utilizing the geopave system. These pavements also perform as natural on-site stormwater detention, storing water in the base for natural percolation without the need for a large isolated detention pond. The geopave units come in 20 by 40 inch panels covering about 5.4 square feet, but they can easily be field cut or staggered to accommodate curves, so you are not locked into a linear path. The geopave system was a great choice for this project with a quick and easy installation, the ability to allow water to flow through the system and not run off into the pond, and also providing a smooth, clean surface for walking and hiking. The standard geopave units are black, but a tan geopave is an option that allows natural blending with light colored stone. Again, the options available for the final design of the trails are what make using this system so versatile and a great choice for any project. The last option that we'll look at for trail surfaces is the GeoTerra system. These are construction mats that are strong yet lightweight and don't require any fill. Because no fill is required, they are perfect for areas where infill resources are scarce. Because there's no fill material, GeoTerra trails won't kill the existing vegetation they are placed over. They are open on both the top and bottom and allow for vegetation to grow through them for as long as they are in place, which is essential for minimizing environmental impacts for trails and pathways. GeoTerra units cover approximately 5 square feet each and can be connected to cover a larger area as needed. The mats are strong enough to support heavy vehicle and construction traffic loads, so obviously will work for trail loading, and have enough flexural strength to bridge soft soils without warping or cracking. And again, these mats are also created or made out of recycled HDPE. The GeoTerra units are connected with strong metal connectors to essentially form a floating road through wetlands with very soft soils. The connected mat system distributes loading across the pavement, minimizing potential for rutting or sinking into soft, muddy soils. In some areas of Alaska, hundreds of miles of ATV trails cut across the tundra, which is frozen solid in the winter, but basically becomes a very soft wetland during the summer. So ATVs can cause extensive damage to natural preserves. As they ride through these wet areas, the riders can cause the loss of vegetative cover and habitat values. And the GeoTerra mats offer a great solution for low impact access in these wet and environmentally sensitive areas. The preferred method is to place the units across the entire trail width, but in some cases, just the wheel paths will be acceptable. As planned, indigenous grasses regenerated through the permeable open cell GeoTerra mats, ultimately camouflaging the product with the natural environment and protecting the vegetation from damage. In this case, the system ultimately ended up as a permanent structure, and the GeoTerra mats will be able to last for as long as needed. That's all we're going to cover on trail surfaces. Now we're going to move away from the flat surface of the trail to the embankments that may be alongside or near the trail. Green walls can help create the space for trails to run through and work with permeable trails to allow water flow and promote vegetation. The same GeoWeb GeoCell technology that creates the trail surface can also be adapted to create retaining walls, such as this vegetated levee. The GeoWeb panels are stacked vertically, one on top of another, to create the wall, allowing for more horizontal space for the trail to be placed. The primary benefit of the geoweb wall is to create a stable, natural living structure with vegetation for aesthetic appeal. The open front fascia allows rainwater to infiltrate, and the wall structure can also absorb some runoff from the top of the wall, such as if you have an impermeable walking trail on top. While vegetated walls are the most common when using geoweb, aggregate filled walls are also possible. Using the same open graded stone we've been talking about, water can infiltrate through the wall, so there isn't runoff onto your road or trail. An aggregate wall may be useful when you don't want to worry about maintaining vegetation in an area, such as an emergency response space, or in areas where vegetation is difficult to establish. The walls are designed as either gravity or reinforced walls in the same way as mechanically stabilized earth or MSE wall systems. An advantage that geoweb walls have over MSE block walls is flexibility in poor soil conditions. Their relatively lightweight and flexible nature allow them to tolerate reasonable differential settlement very well. Another advantage over traditional walls, such as gabion walls, is the relatively shallow embedment depth of the wall and the ability to create a very steep wall face, as steep as 80 degrees. Walls can be built in channels with limited space, such as through neighborhoods, without the need for heavy unloading delivery vehicles. The steep side slopes of the channel mean that the horizontal footprint is much smaller than if the side slopes needed to be shallower. The small required construction footprint is well received by residents of neighborhood projects. It is always necessary to consider live and dead loads that the wall will experience, especially when placed near trails or roads. Dead loads can be buildings or soil slopes above the wall. Live loads are generally going to be construction traffic and long-term vehicle traffic. When possible, the load should be placed away from the edge of the wall or fascia. But if that's not possible, the walls can be designed to support and withstand whatever live and dead loads are placed on top of it. Having traffic barriers at the top of the wall, such as this wooden fence, will help keep the loads away from the geoweb system, which can help lower the cost of the design. We'll now look at a vegetated retaining wall case study. This project was faced with having to retain soils in a very problematic soft soil area, but piling systems were expensive and they wanted to maintain the natural environment. Concrete and modular block walls were also considered, but ultimately they chose the vegetated geocell wall for its natural aesthetics and lower cost. Here you can see the wall structure is constructed with a slight setback to allow for topsoil fill and vegetation. The backfill material is a good drainable aggregate. The wall can be seeded either by mixing the seed in the soil before installation, by broadcasting the seed after the construction, or by hydroseeding the entire wall once the installation is complete. As mentioned, the system's inherent ability to withstand some differential settlement in soft soil environments was extremely important at this site. The wall had varying heights along its length, which was also easily accommodated by the geocell system. By using the geocell wall, they didn't have to bring in invasive equipment such as augers or H-piles, which sped up the installation process and saved cost. Here's the completely vegetated wall. The horizontal terraces allow rainwater collection, helping to minimize runoff and erosion. Pretty much any type of grass or flowering vegetation will survive on these walls. So by using local vegetation, upkeep can be kept to a minimum. Presto does offer a free software for designing geoweb retaining walls and slopes. It's available on our website, which is prestogeo.com, and can be used by engineers and designers to determine if the geoweb system is appropriate for your project. There are a lot of resources on the website on how to use and interpret the software, but we are always happy to help with any questions or recommendations. So far, we have looked at trail surfaces as well as retaining walls. And the final area that we're going to cover then is going to be slope protection, which is typically going to be appropriate when you have less steep slope requirements. It's a good way to protect slopes against erosion when the slope is shallower than what would be required for your retaining wall. Generally speaking, the slope protection system is suitable for globally stable slopes that are about 60 degrees or shallower. If there are questions about this type of application, we're happy to talk you through the specifics of your project. There are three main infill types for slopes, depending on the type of protection needed. We can fill with topsoil and vegetate, use a variety of different aggregates or granular material, and we can also fill the cells with concrete. We'll focus on topsoil and vegetation infill, as that's typically what is selected in trail applications to keep things looking as natural as possible. Here's a simplified diagram showing how the different system components interact with the geoweb to form a complete system. We'll talk about each of these components next, but first we'll just look at the slope itself. Important dimensions that we need in order to make a recommendation on anchorage would be your slope length, your slope angle, as well as your subgrade material. So generally, the way these slopes are constructed, the first thing that would go down would be a geosynthetic layer, which can be a geotextile or a geomembrane. Typically, we're going to try to stay away from these for vegetated solutions, but we do generally recommend a geotextile if our infill material is dissimilar from our subgrade material. Then we put the geoweb in place. Note how the geoweb has a horizontal turn near the top of the slope. This is important for crest anchorage and erosion control. By turning the geoweb down in an anchor trench, we're going to provide some frictional resistance to prevent the geoweb from sliding down the slope. And we'll also prevent any water from being able to get under that system, which could cause us issues from below. We have two options for anchoring. One is using stakes. These are placed mid-slope and at the crest. The number and spacing of the stakes is dependent, again, on the slope length and the slope angle. The other option is to use tendons and a dead man, with the dead man being a buried pipe, concrete anchor, or earth or rock anchors at the crest. The geoweb's then filled with the desired infill material, and if vegetated, an erosion control blanket or hydroseeding is typically used until vegetation is established. The attrakee is the first component for a completely integrated system. This will be used to connect the sections together, both side to side and end to end, to create a single web that covers the entire slope. It allows for faster installation of the geoweb and will last the lifetime of the project, ensuring that the slope is protected and that the geoweb system will not fail under anticipated loads. As slope angle increases, the driving force of the infill material exceeds the available frictional resisting force, and additional anchorage is required. We've got Atra anchors, which are our special patented clips that fit on top of a number 4 or half inch diameter rebar. These are used to hold the geoweb to the slope and penetrate into the ground. If corrosion resistance is required due to project conditions, we have a HDPE Atra speed stake, which you can see in the lower left-hand corner, that is designed to work with the geoweb and being made out of plastic will not corrode long-term. For long steep slopes, slopes where the native soil is highly erodible, or over a surface that cannot be punctured, such as a liner, tendons can be used. The Atra tendon clips transfer the load from heavy infill material to the tendons and crest anchor system. Only the Atra tendon clip is specifically designed to fully transfer safely and securely the forces placed upon the geocell. Every accessory and every feature has been designed and tested to specifically work together so that we go from problem to design to construction solution with a system where the modeling replicates the real world forces. Now we'll take a very quick look at a couple of slope protection projects associated with trails. The one we see here is the American Tobacco Trail. It's a 20-mile rails to trails project running from Durham County to Chatham County, North Carolina. The slope had to be reconstructed after it was excavated in conjunction with the replacement of a culvert. After the culvert was replaced, the slope was regraded to its original 1.3 to 1 slope, and it needed to be revegetated. As we can see from the completed picture, the geoweb slope protection system provided the perfect solution. Then another great example of using geoweb for slope protection is on a trail at the Lance Armstrong Bikeway in downtown Austin, Texas. Here they did do some hard surfacing on the trail, but once they transitioned to vegetation, they used the geoweb to hold the soil in place and make sure it did not erode while that vegetation became established. In summary, Presto Geosystems offers geoweb, geopave, and geoterra that can meet any trail design needs, as well as geoweb for earth retention and slope protection near trails. Each product is designed to protect the surrounding environment while offering a low maintenance surface that won't wash away during heavy rain events. We offer a complete solution, including connections and anchoring options. Part of our complete solution is our technical assistance. We do provide free project design evaluations. We've got a form on our website, which again is prestogeo.com. You can fill it out with as much information as you have, including attaching documents such as geotechnical reports, and that'll go to our engineering team. And then within 3 business days, but most times faster, we will provide a complete design evaluation, including anchorage requirements and geotextile recommendations, along with calculations. We're going to work with you to get you the best design for your project. A couple of quick housekeeping notes before I open things up for questions. You will be getting a follow-up email within the next couple of days, so keep an eye out for that. In this email, you'll have a link to this recorded webinar, which will be located on our YouTube channel. And then you can share that with others who may have missed the presentation, or you can use it for review for yourself in the future. You've also earned 1 PDH credit for participating today. So the email that you receive will provide instructions on how to receive your certificate. You can see my contact information once more on this slide. So if you do have any questions that you think of later, feel free to shoot me an email and I can address them directly with you. Or if you happen to have a potential project that you'd like to discuss, I'd happy to take those questions. So now I'm going to take a look at the questions that have been submitted and see if we can't answer them all, hopefully. Give me one second. I'll try to start from the top. Do you have design recommendation and details for a permeable trail surface or over a relatively impermeable subgrade such as clay soils? I don't know that we have a general detail, but given the specifics of your project, like which sort of rain event you need to design for, as well as how impermeable those subgrade materials are, we could certainly come up with a section that either plan to store all of the stormwater in the increased base depth while it's slowly infiltrated, or we can incorporate perforated pipe in the subgrade or in the base as well, so that we can drain any additional water out to a ditch. There's certainly ways we can deal with it, but we don't have what I would call a standard detail, as each project is going to be different. Is GeoWeb available in small quantities, such as I would use for an aggregate path on each side of my house? We don't judge on the size of the project. You can buy as little as one section, which would be somewhere around 200 square feet, all the way up to several truckloads. So any size project is available. What type of trail materials are best for flood zones for walking and horses? Generally, we're going to have a clean crushed aggregate, and we can size that aggregate based on what sort of flow rates we will find in your specific flood events. But yeah, we might go with something a little bit larger than we typically would in order to make sure that it stays in place. But definitely clean crushed aggregate of some type would be what we'd recommended, what would be what we would recommend for flood zones. Were the tendons and anchors installed by product manufacturer at the plant or the contractor on site? They were installed by the contractor on site. All installations appear level. What is the maximum grade that can be designed for a GeoWeb trail? You know, we can go quite steep on our trails. It would really depend on if it was just a walking trail or if it was a vehicular traffic trail. And in either case, we could probably make something work, but we would need to increase anchorage significantly if we had to plan for vehicles going up and down the trails. But, you know, you can do a 20% grade easily, 25% grade, something like that is not a problem. Could the GeoWeb and aggregate be used as an alternative to asphalt to expand residential driveway parking areas near or in a septic drain field? Yes, that can definitely happen, and we have done similar type applications. What is elevation requirement? Is it needed to be higher or lower than the adjacent ground? Generally speaking, flush with adjacent ground is the best way to do it. It really depends. You know, if you have like a trail that in an area that you're going to need to plow it, you might want to make sure you're a quarter inch above adjacent ground, just so you don't have any issues with the plow running into the surrounding areas. But as close as you can get it to matching adjacent ground, that's the best. Should the geoterra mat be installed over a geotextile fabric for a permanent installation? Can vegetation grow through the fabric? No, you don't. If it's a permanent installation, especially for like a trail application where you won't have very heavy loads, then we don't need a geotextile fabric, and that's really the beauty of it. You're going to have a hard time getting decent vegetation to grow through your geotextile, so if we can avoid it, we definitely would, but we would just need to get a reasonable measure of the subgrade strength as well as the maximum loading, and we could make that recommendation. Are geoterra systems marketed as construction entrance elevate or alternative construction BMPs? Is there sediment removal data? They have been used for construction entrances. There's not really, we don't have specific data on sediment removal, but the nice thing about them is when they do knock mud off of tires, and obviously visually you can see when they're full, you can just pick them up and hose them down and then lay them down again. How thick is the geoterra mat? 2 inches. What types of plants are used for the geoweb vegetated wall? Any plant that will grow in the environment where the wall is suitable. We don't really have any preferences at all. Slope range for green walls. We generally are going to recommend at least a 1 inch setback with each 6 inch lift. And you can set those back all the way to 1:1 if you want to have bigger pockets for larger type vegetation. For geoweb retaining walls, how does the wall hold up to the public climbing on it? I've never heard of anybody wrecking a wall, but I don't know that I have any specific data on that. Is there a minimum permeability specified for the aggregate infill? No, once again, it's really going to depend on what sort of stormwater requirements you have on your site. I mean, we always talk about using permeable infill, but to be honest, you could use road base in there if you don't care about the permeability and it'll function just fine. So it really just depends on the site details. Are tendons installed individually at the site? Yes, they are. Are they labor intensive? No, not really, because with the Atra tendon clip, you're able to install all the tendons before expanding the system. So it really goes quite quickly. Are your shop drawings signed and sealed by a professional engineer? No, they are not. But all of our distributors work with local engineers. So if a signed and sealed drawing is required, we can certainly assist in getting one. Does the GeoWeb system work well with porous concrete? I would imagine it would if you put clean stone underneath it, but I honestly could not point with 100% certainty to an example of where it was used. Do you have to excavate into existing surface to design geoweb trails? No, I mean, if you don't care what your finished grade is, you could build it right above existing grade. It really depends if the finished grade needs to be at a certain elevation. Can the geoweb be placed in the erosive area on the edge of a lake? Yeah, we've done a lot of shoreline protection with geoweb, so it certainly can be used in that. For a project in Alberta, where would the product ship from and what would the lead time be? It really depends what material you're looking at. We have distributors in Canada. They've got offices in Calgary and Edmonton and inventory material in both. But again, depending on exactly what material and how much, they may or may not have it in stock. But worst case scenario, it ships out of northern Wisconsin and would take at most a week to get there. Question for the recreational trail that I'm working on where I may use permeable concrete to reduce drainage impacts and have the geoweb system as a base. Well, yeah, so the geoweb will certainly help to make that permeable concrete last much longer as it will control any settlement below it. So certainly would be a good application to use in that type of a situation. Feel free to shoot me an email directly, Brandon, if you want to talk about that in a little more detail. What combination of product application would you recommend for new trails that are level but run perpendicular to a hillside slope of 20 to 30%? I'd probably use the geoweb. Just anytime you get into those types of grades, the flexible nature of the geoweb is going to work much better than the more rigid geopave panels. Square foot for geoweb installed and just for material. Assuming we're talking about a trail and we use a 4-inch product, you're probably looking at, if we use a geotextile as well, and assuming some anchorage, you might be at $1 a square foot for the materials, maybe $1.50 installed, and then whatever the cost of your infill material is. Don't see any other questions, and it looks like it's 11:56 Central Time. So I will sit on here for two more minutes and see if anybody wants to type any more questions in. Otherwise, once again, I want to thank everyone for your participation, and you should see that follow-up email coming from Presto Geosystems within the next couple of days. So thanks a lot. You see one more question here. Has the geoweb been used in a beach or dune environment? Yes, it has. Generally, you can just fill it right with beach sand and it's quite effective. And we can't even produce the geoweb in a tan color. It's a little bit more cost and custom made, but obviously it tends to blend in a little bit better in those beach environments. And how often are your systems used as inlets to BMPs or as slopes to both wet and dry retention ponds? Relatively frequently. It certainly would not be a challenging application, especially because those ponds are usually 3-to-1 side slopes or something. So certainly can use it for those applications.